Hi everyone, my name is Dr. Arvind Kumar. I am the medicine faculty. Today I will be discussing very important topic of medicine, that is HOCM. As we know, HOCM is hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. Starting with the pathology or the cause of HOCM. Basically, HOCM is autosomal dominant mutation of important proteins of the heart, and two important proteins of the heart, these are myosin binding protein C, which you can see in this figure, as well as beta myosin heavy chain 7 protein. So what happens when there is a mutation of these proteins? There is an asymmetrical hypertrophy of the septum. So here you can look at the asymmetrical hypertrophy of the septum, and that hypertrophy is near the left ventricle outflow tract. So this leads to a type of a stenosis, subvalvular stenosis below the aortic valve. And pathology wise, there is disarrangement of the ventricle fibers or the septal fiber, which you can see in this diagram. Now, how to go about the clinical features? So in the clinical feature, if we look at the symptoms, the first symptom, earliest symptom, is dyspnea. The reason for the dyspnea is left ventricle pressure is high, and that pressure is transmitted to left atria. If left atrial pressures are high, there is a pulmonary congestion, which means dyspnea will be there. Also, patient has outflow obstruction. So during sports, during exercise, what will happen? The cardiac output will not be increased because of the obstruction. So as a result, the blood flow will go to skeletal muscles only, but not to the brain, and patient will have syncope attacks. That will be exertional syncope. Third symptom is angina. So the reason for the angina is increased cardiac workload, as well as hypertrophied muscles. They compress the blood vessels of the heart and leads to decreased blood flow. Angina will occur. More dangerous, because of the angina, there is a risk of ventricle arrhythmias. Any angina or ischemia causes a predisposition for ventricle arrhythmia, and patient can have sudden cardiac death. Meaning of the sudden cardiac death? Death within 1 hour of the symptoms. And HOCM indeed is the most common cause of sudden cardiac death in young patients. Important question. While the signs, starting with the pulse. So you can see in this figure that the pulse, there is an increased force of cardiac contraction because of the obstruction. So the first peak you can see is high, and subsequently when there is a blood flow obstruction, the second peak remains low. This is classically known as the spike and dome pulse, also known as a pointed finger pulse, also known as Bessarion's pulse. So this is a type of a Bessarion's pulse. When we look at the JVP, so we know that JVP is due to right atrial pressures, and in cases of the HOCM, left side is mainly affected, but still we will see the signs of right-sided high pressure. Why it occur? This will occur if this septum compresses the right ventricle, hypertrophied septum, right ventricle pressure increase, and that right ventricle pressure increases the pressure of right atria, and JVP will be increased. This is a very important sign of JVP, known as Bernheim's effect. Important MCQ also. About the cardiac apex. So when we palpate the cardiac apex, it will be a double apex. The meaning of the double apex means the left ventricle apex will be palpable to the finger, as well as S4 presence will make it palpable. S4 can be palpable. So this is a double cardiac apex which will be felt in the HOCM. Why? Coming to the heart sounds, so when we auscultate S1, all of us know S1 is due to the closure of AV valve. But because of the hypertrophy, that sound remain inside the cavity of the ventricle. So the transmission of the sound will be reduced. S2 is because of the aortic valve and pulmonary valve closure. We know that aortic valve close earlier than the pulmonary valve. So this is A2, this is P2. But what will happen if there is an obstruction to left ventricle outflow? So the A2 will become late and it will come beyond the P2. So it is known as a reverse split. Very important. While about the S3 and S4, S3 is the ventricle gallop, and that occur when ventricle blood volume is more than its capacity. For example, when there is a systolic failure, blood retention in the ventricle cavity, or high cardiac output state. While S4 occur when atria contract against a stiff ventricle and ventricle vibrate. That occur because of the ventricle stiffness, which occur in ventricle hypertrophy. So out of S3 and S4, S4 will be more common in HOCM than S3. Now come to the important murmur, the murmur of the HOCM. This occur because of the left ventricle outflow tract obstruction. So you can see in this diagram, the hypertrophic septum is causing the obstruction to ventricle outflow. And also there is one more pathology, that the mitral valve leaflet that is pulled towards the septum, increasing the obstruction further. So this is known as a systolic anterior movement of mitral leaflet. So when we put the stethoscope, we will hear the ejection systolic murmur. Any obstruction to the ventricle outflow will produce a ejection systolic murmur, means turbulence during ejection. Where it will be heard? It will be heard in the left side, third or fourth intercostal space here, because the septum is oblique, and because of the oblique septum, the hypertrophied area will be somewhere here on the left side, third or fourth intercostal space. How to differentiate from the aortic valvular stenosis? This murmur of HOCM does not radiate, while a valvular aortic stenosis murmur radiate to the carotid. Important difference. As well as the maneuver, there are certain maneuvers which will tell us that this is a case of a HOCM, because we know that whenever blood flow increase, all the murmur increase except the murmur of HOCM and MVP. So why the murmur of the HOCM behave differently? So differently means whenever left ventricle blood flow is more, HOCM murmur reduces. Whenever blood flow in the ventricle is less, the murmur increase. This is the exception of HOCM. Reason is very simple. Reason is when there is a more blood in the ventricle cavity, it will keep the septum and the leaflet away from each other, and the obstruction will reduce. And when the blood is less in the ventricle cavity, the septum and leaflet, they will come more in close contact, increasing the obstruction, increasing the murmur. The other factors which decide the murmur is the contractility. Contractility of the septum, what it do? The septum contraction pull the leaflet more towards the septum. So this increase the obstruction. So more contractility, more obstruction, and increase the murmur. So based on this pharmacotherapy, we can say that whatever drug decreases the contractility will be helpful here, that is beta blocker, and whatever drug which reduces the preload into the ventricle will increase the murmur, like venodilators and the diuretic therapy. Now the murmur also, it will be affected by the pressure gradient. Now what is a pressure gradient of HOCM? Pressure gradient of the HOCM will be a left ventricle pressures minus aorta pressures. So if you reduce the aorta pressures, the gradient will increase, murmur will increase. If you increase the aorta pressures, the difference will reduce, murmur will reduce. So these are the factors which affect the intensity of the murmur in HOCM. Now the ECG. So in the ECG, we will get the signs of left ventricle hypertrophy, means V5, V6 will show increased amplitude of the QRS complexes, as well as signs of ischemia will be seen, which means the T wave will be inverted, and indeed it is giant inverted T wave which can be seen here. As you can see in this ECG diagram, the T wave is grossly inverted, more than 10 mm is the inversion, giant T wave inversion that is seen in a apical variant of HOCM, which is known as the Yamaguchi syndrome. While in the echocardiography, three important things you will see: that left ventricle wall thickness will be more than 15 mm. The septum to posterior wall thickness ratio, indeed this is the most important diagnostic criteria for HOCM, that will be more than 1.3. And you can see the banana shaped left ventricle cavity, banana shaped left ventricle cavity due to septum bulging into the left ventricle. Now, how the management should be done? As you can see in this flowchart, two scenario will be there. First is left ventricle outflow obstruction, maybe at rest or with exercise. Three important points: patient asymptomatic, patient is mildly symptomatic, and patient has drug refractory severe heart failure. So when the patient is asymptomatic, no treatment is done, just observation. While if patient is mildly symptomatic, then beta blocker can be given here. While in a refractory case or a severe CHF, surgical myectomy will be done in that situation, or maybe alcohol septal ablation that reduces the mass of the septal side. Now, if HOCM is non-obstructive, which you can see, again asymptomatic patient, mildly symptomatic, and severe patient CHF, NYHA class 3 and 4. So, asymptomatic patient, no treatment, symptomatic patient, mildly symptomatic, beta blocker will be given. While if the patient is refractory to drugs or severe CHF, in that condition, transplant will be needed. Now, coming to these patients have a very important complication, that is a sudden cardiac death, which is due to ventricular arrhythmia. What should be done in that? So in that scenario, ICD devices are very, very important, implantable cardioverter devices, defibrillator device. So they sense the arrhythmia and deliver the DC shock. So it will be of two types. Secondary prevention means ki the arrhythmia has already occurred, we have to prevent the subsequent episode of arrhythmia. So the indication is, of course, if patient is a survivor of a cardiac arrest or has sustained ventricle tachycardia, put the ICD. While primary prevention means we have to prevent the first attack of the ventricle arrhythmia to prevent the sudden cardiac death. So out of these, more than equal to two criteria should be satisfied, two factors should be there. First, family history of sudden cardiac death, syncope attacks, low blood pressure in response to treadmill test, non-sustained ventricle tachycardia, and ventricle wall thickness more than equal to 30. If any two of these are present, put the patient on the ICD device. So this was the discussion of a very important disease, that is HOCM. So hopefully you like this video, and if you have any doubts or queries, you can put your questions in the comment section. Thank you all of you.